Would you sell your business for $235 million? Just a question. Would you, or would you be like, nah, no thanks, Edgewell. I'm going to hang on right now. Gentlemen, welcome back to the Tiege Hanley Starting a Business, Building a Brand vlog. This one, big number, 247. Now, just let me get this out of the way. I am not talking about Tiege Hanley. I'm talking about something that recently happened with another big monster-like grooming brand, bigger than Tiege Hanley, called Cremo. For those of you who have no idea who Cremo is, they're essentially like a men's grooming company, right? They started, I believe, with like beard and shave cream, and then they transitioned into grooming, skincare, body washes, deodorants, bars of soap. They do like pretty much everything, right? And they have recently just announced that they've been, or I should say, Edgewell announced that they were buying Cremo for $235 million. Now, Edgewell, if it sounds familiar, they are also buying other like big products and big brands, right? They also recently bought Jack Black, the skincare company, along with Bulldog, another men's skincare company. And this is the newest acquisition for them. And so today what I thought I would do is talk a little bit about this whole like acquisition like strategy. Why big companies do it? Should you do it if you're a small company? And what it kind of looks like in terms of how it sort of works. I'm also going to talk a little bit about would Tiege Hanley possibly be interested in selling to a monster brand for millions and millions and millions and millions and millions and millions and millions, millions, millions of dollars. I don't know. I'm not saying we would. I'm saying, though, it would probably be pretty damn tempting. Anyway, what the hell was I talking about? Anyway, something else I'm going to talk a little bit about is an incredible question that we got on the last vlog, which nobody watched. I don't know why nobody cared about how to get financing to start your business. I think that's a pretty solid topic, all right? But the deal is there was a question about franchising. There was also a question about how do you know or how do you go about or how should I better read it. It says, what do you think of buying a business instead of building one? Capital will be also raised as debt or equity, just as building a business from scratch. So this is an incredible question. It sort of ties into this whole concept of you start a business, you build it up, and then a big monster, giant business is like, yo, you look pretty good. You're pretty sassy. What do you think? You come and hang out with me a little bit, and they offer you some crazy amount of money. Usually it is some multiple of gross revenue. And you are faced with a position or in a position to be like, yeah, I think this makes sense, or no, I'm not really interested in selling my business. So here's the deal. It is very common in terms of the world that we live in for businesses, bigger businesses, to cannibalize or buy smaller businesses. And there are a few reasons for that. Reason number one is that they see it as a value add, right? Maybe there's a big company and they're not doing skincare, they're not doing this, but they have a customer base of a similar demographic. Maybe they're doing hair care and they're like, yo, you know what would really be sweet? What if we bought a grooming company or that did shave or skincare or something, and now we could basically have their customer base, because that's one of the things that these companies buy. If you have a massive customer base, and that is one of the reasons why Dollar Shave Club sold for like $1 billion, they had like 2.5 million customers. And so the company that bought them was like, yo, these are 2.5 million people. Did I say 2.5 million? Anyway, or did I say 1,000? It was 2.5 million customers Dollar Shave Club had, and they ended up selling for $1 billion. Dollar Shave Club had already done like all the hard work, all the legwork to build up their customers. And this other business was like, yo, we want your customers. We can sell them more stuff. We think that because we're a bigger, who bought Dollar Shave Club? Let me check. Unilever, a big grooming company. They've got a lot of different brands underneath them. I believe like Axe is under them. I suck so bad. Hold on. Google search. What brands does Unilever own? All right. Just wait for it. I'm sorry. Is this exciting? Ben and Jerry. Okay. So they own like everything. They own a lot of things. They own Dove. They own Lynx, which is Axe. They own Radix, Sure, Surf. They own Vaseline. They own a lot of different like big brands, right? And so they were like, yo, we're not really in the razor game. We want to be. And so Dollar Shave Club did something that they weren't doing. They had a massive customer base. And so they're like, here you go. Here's $1 billion. Give it over. Now, the beautiful thing is that Dollar Shave Club did an incredible job like building their business. They had raised like a ton of money throughout a lot of different like investors, equity firms, and stuff like that. And so what happened, and this is something just I remember off the top of my head, I believe it was at the time that Dollar Shave Club sold their business, I believe the founder of Dollar Shave Club, Mike, I believe he had 9%, only 9% of his equity. We've talked about equity. I believe, and I could be wrong, but bear with me. I'm pretty sure it was like 9% he had left. And so you sell for $1 billion, you got 9%. That is $90 million that Mike walked with. And all the investors, all the people that put up all the money in order to facilitate Dollar Shave Club's growth, they, you know, got paid out based on their percentage of equity. And so, you know, that is why Dollar Shave Club got bought. All right, Unilever wanted to be in shave. They loved the fact that Dollar Shave Club had this massive business. Boom, let me sell it, and the legwork is done. Bigger companies are just gobbling up and buying smaller entities, bringing them in-house, and adding them to their portfolio of brands to make this big company even bigger. Now, in terms of how to determine how much your company could potentially be sold for, there are so many different variables in it. One of the reasons why Dollar Shave Club got such a high multiple was because of the fact that they were a subscription service, right? Like Tiege Hanley. Tiege Hanley is a subscription service, and so they typically will get a little bit better valuation because they've got reoccurring revenue. A company comes and they're like, yo, you got 2.5 million people that are every month gonna be generating money. You're not starting from zero every month. And so those companies typically are gonna be a little bit more valuable. Depending on the space that you're in, this is also gonna determine what the standard like multiple is for your gross revenue. Typically, a company is going to get a multiple or like a multiplication, right? Maybe 1, 2, 3, 4 of their gross revenue, all right? And so depending on your business, depending on the industry, depending on the sector, depending on who is buying it and how valuable you are, this is really going to determine, you know, what somebody is willing to pay and what you can expect to get. But sometimes the valuations can get like crazy. All right, so like we talked about, Cremo was bought for $235 million. Now, I've seen different like reports in terms of how much annual revenue Cremo is doing, and somewhere I believe it's between like $50 and like $70 million. Now, once again, the majority of Cremo's business was retail brick and mortar. But if you do the math, right, you take like, say, 60 million, we'll use that number, you divide 235 by 60 million, and you get a multiple of like 3.9. That is essentially what they got based on their gross revenue, how much money they're actually doing in sales per year. So let's think about this for a second. Say you're a business, and you're doing, say, just for easy numbers, $10 million. If a company comes to you and says, hey, we'll give you a 3.9 multiple on your gross revenue, $10 million. What does that leave you with? Do the math. Ready? Can you fit $39 million? Would you take it? Well, it depends. And why does it depend? Well, let's talk about why it depends. Say you're in a fast growth trajectory, right? And somebody comes in and you know that in like 2 years, you're projecting to be at like 20 million or 30 million, right? And you've got sort of the infrastructure and you are growing like really fast, right? If somebody comes to you and you know this, like, hey, we'll buy your business today, cash in hand, for $39 million, right? But you know in 2 years you're going to be at $20 million, and then what's your value? Do the math. $78 million by you not selling now and you just hanging on and sitting tight, right? If the multiple stayed the same and you knew that you were growing. Now, what some of these companies will do is if they sort of spot you and they think, I think this business is going to do pretty well. Right now, we know that they're probably around like $10 million, but we think that we can get them or help them, or we think that they've got potential to grow. They'll try and come in like early on and be like, hey, come here. They'll come in early before you get to that big so that they don't have to actually pay out that much, and they'll offer you sort of, you know, money up front right now, cash in hand, take it. And, you know, you've got to decide. Is a bird in the hand? What is it? What is the saying? A bird in the hand worth two in the bush? What is the saying? I got to check. Bird in the hand worth two in the bush. Meaning, is it better to have that money right now, or are you gonna gamble? Because honestly, it's a gamble. You don't know what's gonna happen. You don't know if your business is going to actually get there. What happens? Like coronavirus, right? Nobody really saw that coming, and that could have absolutely destroyed your plans. And there are a lot of businesses probably that are sitting there thinking, damn, I should have took the money and ran if I would have known. Now they're crippled, now they're hurt. So you're gambling a little bit, but it's very exciting. It's very exciting that the men's grooming space is growing the way that it is. It's very exciting that, you know, these companies that start, you know, just like Tiege Hanley or just like yours are growing and being valuable. Now, just so you know, nobody has offered any money for Tiege Hanley, and whether or not we would sell it, we don't know. You know, Rob and Kelly and myself have talked about, you know, what happens if somebody comes and offers us, you know, a lot of money? What would we do? And we haven't decided. We don't know, because honestly, it would have to be the right fit with the right company, and it would have to be, you know, the right amount of money, honestly. We don't know. We've talked about it. Like, hey, what would our number be, right? Because I guess that's something that you'd have to consider. Now, you know, for me, in this entrepreneurial world, I see a lot of, like, my friends, not my friends, but people that I'm, like, kind of closely connected with. It's almost like a badge of honor to have an exit, right? Everybody talks about the exit. Well, Tiege Hanley, we never started Tiege Hanley to have the exit. We started it because we wanted to do something special. We started it because we wanted to grow a business. But the way that you sort of plan in terms of in your head, if you are planning on trying to have an exit versus a lifestyle business and grow it profitably, the way that you go about running it, the way that you go about raising money for it, it's very different. Certain businesses that know, hey, I want to sell this someday for X, know that you need to generate a lot of sales, right? We need to grow it to this monstrous number so that a company will find us attractive and pay us a big multiple. And so oftentimes what they do is they raise a lot of money. This is exactly what Dollar Shave Club did. They raise money after money after money after money after money, diluting. The only option for them was to get bought, because they were not running a profitable business. It was not like, hey, we got millions of dollars in profit every year. It wasn't that at all. They were very heavily leveraged. And so, you know, that was the only option for them, honestly. And I truly feel that in today's world, today's market, today's climate, you really don't want to count on that. It's better to run a business from the perspective of, we want to run this business smart. We want to be lean. We want to be profitable. We want to grow our business, not necessarily organically, but if it means that you've got to be a little bit slower in your growth versus like super big, super fast, like here you go, I think that's smart. I think that's better. I truly believe that a lot of the big companies that are looking to buy smaller companies, they are looking for profitable companies, not just big companies. You know, now that's just my opinion. I don't know that for 100% fact, but it's better to be prepared. It's better to be profitable versus just like monstrous and big, in my opinion. Now you're thinking to yourself, damn, what would I do if I sold my business? Well, the truth is, oftentimes when a company comes to you and says, hey, we want to buy your business, there is a process, right? It's not just like somebody like hands you like 235 million bucks, you toss them the keys and it's like deuces. Typically, that's not how it works. I'm sure sometimes it does, but generally speaking, the way that it works, there is a buyout period. And if somebody, you know, buys your company, you have to continue to work at the company for X number of months or years or whatever it may be. Now, sometimes, you know, you're going to stay on. Like, I think with Dollar Shave Club, they allowed or kept the management team. Certain businesses that are buying your company, especially if they don't have or they don't already do what you do, they don't want to rock the boat. They don't want to bring in all new people. You have made this business successful because of your successes, your talents, your strategy. Why would they want to rock the boat? You've been kicking ass. And so oftentimes they will keep the management team in place. Sometimes they'll get rid of people, like if there's redundancy, right? Like if your business has an accountant and another business has an accountant and they merge, yeah, you may keep your job, but typically these type of skills will be taken in-house by the bigger company. But a lot of the strategy, a lot of the marketing, a lot of the leadership, upper management, the executives of the company, a lot of times they are going to stay on, or at least have to stay on for a specific amount of time until this new company that buys you is going to come in and sort of get all their people involved. And so, was that interesting? Gentlemen, was that interesting? Speaking of interesting, muscle soreness. It happens to the best of us. It really happens if you're just starting a workout plan, right? When you first start, you're like, yeah, at first you're working out and you're like, yeah, this is awesome. My biceps, they're so swollen, right? And then the next day you're like, oh my God, I can't straighten my arms, or oh, I can't sit down on the toilet. If you work out, if you squat, you know exactly what I'm talking about. The deal is, the muscle soreness is a result of lactic acid, right? The way that working out works, right? You lift weights, resistance training, it shreds the muscle fibers. When the muscle fibers are shredded, it releases lactic acid. Too much makes you super sore. Well, gentlemen, today, the link below is going to take you through a video about how to reduce muscle soreness. It is from Tiege Hanley. We're not only making you handsome, we're making you less sore. we're also going to be now answering some of your amazing, too specific business questions. The first business question comes from our friend, Your Artist. He says, can you explain what franchising is and how it works? In a nutshell, franchising is when a company or a person starts a business, right? They start a business and it is successful. And what they have done is they have basically figured out a structured system in how to tell somebody else how to do exactly the same thing, all right? So let's use Subway restaurants for example, right? Subways, they make the subs. All right, there was a dude or a woman, I'm not sure who, that started the first Subway shop. They were like, yo, this is a Subway, and it was successful. And they're like, yo, this is a pretty cool business. I'm gonna open up another one, right? And so they open up another one. They duplicate the system, all the ingredients, all of the colors, it is identical. Well, then they got the idea, and I don't know if this is Subway's story, it's probably not, I'm just using them as an example. Somebody came to them like, hey, I'd like to open one of these. I think it's pretty cool, I love your sandwiches. The dude that started Subway's like, I guess I could teach you exactly what I do and why I'm successful. And so the other dude is like, yeah, let's do this. And so the dude who started Subway is like, all right, I want $50,000 for me to tell you how to do it, but you're also gonna need probably about $250,000 additional dollars in order to set everything up and make your store sexy and pretty like mine, along with buy your meat, right? You also are gonna have to pay me a royalty. Every year, I want a percentage of what your business is. I feel I deserve it because, well, I started this and I'm giving you the blueprint and allowing you to do this. And then the person's like, okay, here you go. They pay him the $50, the franchise fee, and then they start their business, they spend the additional $250,000 to set it up, and then once a year, or however often it is, that person, that franchisee, is going to pay the original franchisor a percentage of the profits. It's predetermined. Then somebody else sees, and oh wow, there are three Subways, I think I would like one of those, and so they then go to Mr. Subway, whoever started it, and said, I also would like one. And so $50,000, you got to set it up, $250,000, and then the cycle repeats. Essentially, in a nutshell, that's what a franchise is. Somebody starts a business and then sells you the rights to use their logo, use their marketing material. Basically, they're giving you the secret sauce, as it would. The other upside to buying a franchise, especially when it's a big franchise, like a McDonald's or like a Subway, I was going to say Chick-fil-A, but they're a different animal in and of themselves, is that now all of a sudden the big company, the corporation, typically will handle the marketing and the brand awareness. And as you know, because you're smart and you've been watching our vlog, you know that the marketing is the hardest part of this. But if you're somebody that already knows what a Subway is, you're driving down the interstate, you see a sign for a Subway, you're like, oh, I already know what a Subway is because I've seen the commercials, they're already, you know, in my town, I know that I love it, I know that what I'm gonna get there is exactly what I got at the other one. And so that's the other reason why somebody would wanna buy a franchise. Brand recognition, and you know what you're gonna get. You're also going to be paying in, typically as a franchisee, some money to marketing, right? And so you are marketing on a big macro scale, but you reap the rewards from a micro level, meaning like your store, you are getting the rewards of the big advertising campaign nationally that Subway is doing. Does that make sense? So why would you want to buy a franchise, right? Why wouldn't you want to just start your own business and just figure it out yourself? And the reason is because figuring it out yourself costs a lot of money and a lot of years of experience. And this is a way to sort of like circumvent all those years or that road, you know, say we talk about success being a journey, right? And you gotta drive the road, you gotta hit speed bumps. This is like the overpass, right? You gotta clear ride. Somebody else has already done the hard work and gone through those speed bumps and taken the road. And they're like, oh no. It's a lot easier. Just take this bridge I built you. And that's kind of my analogies are either horrible or they're awesome. Which one? Gentlemen down below, let me know. Say, yo, Alpha, your analogies, I get it, or I have no idea what the hell you're talking about. Anyway, let me now bring it and tie it together. Yeah, right. With the last business question, he says, that's not where it is. Wait for it. All right. What do you think of buying a business instead of building one? Capital will be raised as debt or equity, just like building a business from scratch. And I think we kind of just answered that. I think it depends. I think it depends on you. I think it depends on the business. And I think it depends on if you want to cut out a lot of the learning curve that has to be done and taken into consideration when building a business from scratch. And I think really this whole vlog has been about, you know, the pros and cons and what you can expect. And if you want to buy somebody else's business, I think that you should do it. I think you should look into it. I think you should really do your due diligence to make sure that the business is what they say they are. Because oftentimes when somebody comes in or approaches a company and like, hey, we would like to potentially buy your business, you know, you just got to make sure that everything is on the up and up, right? You got to look at the books. You've got to do your research, because I would hate for you to buy a business only to find out that the books were cooked or something wasn't as rosy as you thought it would be. And that, gentlemen, is where I'm going to wrap things up. My question to you is, would you sell for $235 million even if your business was doing like 70? I guess it all depends on, like, if you're making, you know, $40 million profit a year, you're like, yeah, I'm good, right? Why? It depends. Like I said, there are a lot of factors that goes into deciding whether or not to sell, whether or not somebody's going to buy you, and hopefully you are lucky enough to figure that out someday. Gentlemen, speaking of lucky, we are lucky to have you. Hopefully you got something from this incredibly rambling vlog. I use a lot of weird analogies. Hopefully you got them. If not, I'm sorry. If you have a business question, down below, start it with business question and ask your question. Next week, we'll get to some of them. We'll also give you an update on Tiege Hanley. Some exciting stuff happening. But the most exciting thing is that you are hanging out with me. Gentlemen, thank you so much for hanging, because at Tiege Hanley, we love you, as always, more than our double monk strap shoes. Guys, thanks for watching. Have an incredible weekend and stay safe, because we love you.